It's gonna be okay with the love. Easter is just kind of a day you show up at church. We're just so grateful that you would take some time to be here. We just hope that today you experience the love of God, the grace of God, the story of the gospel of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, and the implication it has for us today. I know we got some kids in the room. We're so grateful that you would be here and raise your kids to show up to church on an Easter morning. For those of you that are guests with kids, just want to let you know they are more than welcome to stay in here with us, more than welcome to make some noise. We're really glad that you're here with your kids. But if you would like, there is kids ministry available. If you go into the lobby and take a right up through fifth grade, there's classes for kids. If you got a little one that's making a little more noise or needs a little bit of space, again, if you just go through these double doors back in the lobby, there's a space right outside these windows where you can still see service, and there's some snacks and some room for your kids out there, and you're more than welcome to take advantage of that as well.
We're just going to enter into a time of worship this morning, and being Easter Sunday, as believers, like, this is the most easy time to worship our Lord, right? Like, we're all excited for what is going on, but I just want to take a minute to think about, Kyle talked about this at Good Friday, if you guys were there, the service up at Mac, but him saying it is finished on the cross, and just, like, realizing that it is finished for all time. Like, it is finished that he beat death and sin for all time, for all people. Whether you're a believer or not, he did that for you. And so we're just going to enter into a time of worship knowing that it is finished. You don't have to work for anything. Like, he did it, and you just have to receive it. And it is such good news, and that's why we're going to worship this morning, because we serve a Jesus who did it for us, and he's alive, and we're excited to just give him glory this morning. So please join us with worship, and we're just excited to be here.
If you have prayer that you have, a prayer need you have, we've got a team over here that's available for you under the Prayer and Praise banner. Anytime during this time of worship, please feel free to go join them. But Lord, we love you. We're here to worship you, to celebrate your resurrection, that you overcame sin, overcame death for us, and you've given us hope. So we worship from a position of hope this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
There was a moment the lights went out, and death acclaimed its victory. The King of Love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. They're on the cross, it's India. They're on the cross, they made for the sin.
you're going to bring more energy. I think you're also the smartest because you don't have to worry about obligations for teardown when we're done. You guys got to figure it out. Those second service suckers are going to feel real awkward when we're going to start stacking chairs. You guys are incredible. Happy Easter. For those of you that are guests, my name is Kyle Smith. I'm the lead pastor here at Anchor Church. We've got an amazing team of leaders and staff, and so grateful to be a part of what God is doing here at Anchor. It's a church that we planted, started about 3.5 years ago, and just seen the faithfulness of God and love Missoula, love this community, love how God is building this community, and grateful to have you here this Easter with us. Those of you that are watching online, wherever you're at, just so grateful you take some time out of Easter to be here with us as well. If you have your Bible today, we're going to look at 1 Peter chapter 1 as we look at an Easter message, looking at the resurrection of Jesus. If you do have your Bible, 1 Peter is towards the very back. If you don't have a Bible with you, we're going to try to put all the scriptures that we reference up on the screen behind me so that you're able to follow along there. When we look at 1 Peter chapter 1, the way we're going to go about this, I'm just going to read the 6 verses we're going to talk about today. I'll read all 6 verses, and then we're going to go back, kind of walk through them verse by verse. And I think if we read it all up front, we kind of got the context of where we're going, and then we'll make some observations out of these verses as we walk through them. But 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1 says this: "This letter is from Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. I am writing to God's chosen people who are living as foreigners in the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. God the Father knew you and chose you." That we have been born again because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Now we live with great expectation, and we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled beyond the reach of change and decay. And through your faith, God is protecting you by his power until you receive the salvation, which is ready to be revealed on the last day for all to see. So be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. I'm going to read that last verse again. So be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. We're going to look at these 6 verses, kind of the way we're looking at it today. Verses 1 through 3, we'll talk about for a few minutes. And those are kind of like the appetizer. And then we're going to get to verses 4 and 6, which is like the main course. And so there's a lot that we can pull out of all of this, but we're going to really let verses 1 through 3 kind of set us up for the truth that Peter speaks to us in verses 4 through 6. Verse 1 tells us both the author of this letter and the original audience that it was written to. And I think it's important for us to take just a moment to consider that. It says in verse 1 that this letter is written by Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Now, Peter is one of the apostles of Jesus. He was one of the closest friends of Jesus. He was one of the big three, Peter, James, and John, always with Jesus for his 3 years of earthly ministry. Witnessed amazing works of Jesus. Walked with him for his years of ministry. Peter's a guy who had some really high highs and some really low lows as he walked with Jesus. He's the guy who had the high high of he walked on top of water with Jesus. He's the one guy who got to do that. And he has this amazing moment. He has the high high of Jesus looking at him and says, you are Peter, and on this rock I'm going to build my church. He's got some great moments with Jesus. He also has some low lows. Peter's the guy who, when Jesus is arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane and he's put on trial overnight, that Peter kind of keeps a bit of a distance, but he wants to see what's going to happen with Jesus. And 3 times he's told, aren't you one of Jesus' disciples? Aren't you one of his guys? And Peter 3 times before the rooster crows denied that he even knew who Jesus was. He's a guy that at one point Jesus looks at Peter in the face, and this time he says, "Get behind me, Satan." Jesus says that to you. You've had a bad day. Like this is, he's had some low lows. Peter, as he walks with Jesus, and although he had some good days and he had some bad days, he was some faithful days, some unfaithful days, he sticks with Jesus to the end. he is there as Jesus is arrested and put on trial and crucified. And what I'm considering with Peter is before he pens this letter, is not only did he witness all of this, but Peter, he was there on that very first Easter. Scripture records that Peter wasn't just there and alive, but he went into the empty tomb. He saw the folded grave clothes. Like he was there on that Sunday morning where they anticipated a dead Savior. They hear the news that the tomb is empty, and he runs to the tomb. He busts right in, and he sees that Jesus is not there. It's Peter who later he has conversations and eats with and interacts with the resurrected Jesus. He's able to touch his body and communicate with him, and he's there as he watches his Savior Jesus ascend into the clouds into heaven, saying he'll return someday. He was there, an eyewitness, not just of the life of Jesus and the death of Jesus, but an eyewitness to the resurrected Christ. And then he spends the rest of his days telling anyone and everyone the story he saw. He's telling anyone who will listen around the known world, whether they were Jews or Gentiles, he is going to say, I saw Jesus not just be a great teacher and perform miracles. I saw him resurrected. And he spends his life telling the story of Easter. And it's not always easy for him. In fact, a lot of people don't like it. We see Peter, he ends up getting arrested and he's thrown into prisons and he's got these great escape stories and he's misunderstood and he's accused and he's beaten. Peter, he writes this letter from Rome under the Emperor Nero. History says maybe 62 to 64 AD. He writes the letter we're looking at today. And in 66 AD, he's going to be crucified on a cross upside down because he felt unworthy to die in the same manner as his Jesus. He has witnessed his comrades not just be beaten and imprisoned. He's watched some of his fellow apostles be killed for their faith as well. So Peter, he's got this story that's captivated him. And he spends his entire life sharing the news. And it's not always accepted, and life isn't always easy. In fact, he's experienced suffering. While he's got a hope in Jesus, he is suffering today. And verse 1 continues to say the audience with which Peter writes to is people who are living as foreigners. God's chosen living as foreigners. People who are also enduring suffering and hardship. That Peter is writing to believers in Jesus who are living as exiles, as foreigners, as refugees. Writing to believers in Jesus who in this life are experiencing hardships and trials. In fact, as we jump into later verses that we'll talk about, he speaks specifically to the trials that you are suffering through right now. But he writes to them, a people who have a hope in Jesus and yet are... of this letter, but the content of these verses that will be expanded on throughout this letter is an encouragement to not give up, to persevere, and to keep the big picture in mind. Keep the end in mind. Remember the hope that we have. He's calling people who have put faith in Jesus, but enduring hardships, to keep the end in mind. I think perspective for us in humanity is it's really hard to keep perspective of a big picture when we're in the heat of a battle or when we've got heightened emotions or difficult circumstances. We can see what's happening around us, and it's difficult for us to be reminded of the bigger picture because the emotion... chasing him around the yard, and sweet little precious innocent me had these words fly out of my mouth in the backyard. I yelled, I want to kill you. I was so mad, and he thought it was funny and keeps running, and so I'm chasing him around the backyard. He ends up running into the back door of our house and into the kitchen, and And as I continue to chase him, I bust through the door, end up in the kitchen where my dad is standing. And I don't know if my dad had heard me utter those words in the backyard or if my brother got in there quick enough to report to him what I had been saying. But I run in and I just freeze as dad's there and brother's there. And my dad looks at me. And he takes this moment to kind of shake me out of the emotion of the moment to get a glimpse of the bigger picture. And no judgments in this story, okay? I'm not telling you how to parent, but this is what he did. He reaches over, and he opens the drawer, and he pulls out a butter knife. Now, my brother is old enough to know there is no danger in this butter knife. I'm young enough to know I'm not allowed to touch a knife because if you touch it, you're probably going to die. He grabs his butter knife, which I think is just the ultimate weapon. And he reaches over and he hands it to me. And I hold this butter knife. And my dad looks at me and says, go ahead. I was like, huh? He's like, if you wanted to kill him, like, go ahead. And in this moment, like, everything just starts swirling. And I'm like, I actually don't want to kill him. Like, I don't want to live the rest of my life without a brother. I don't want the guilt and the shame that I killed my brother with a butter knife. And so I break in this moment. I'm like, I don't want to, and I give the knife back. And it was like this shaking out of the emotion of the moment that was so real and so frustrating to the bigger picture of like, no, I don't want that. I think that Peter, in a similar way, he's writing like, I know that the tragedy that you're walking through, you have loved ones who are actually dying right now. There is sickness in there. You've been heartbroken and that you have had to leave your country to go be a refugee somewhere else. I know that it's hard right now. You have real emotion. You have real trials, but I want you to keep the big picture in mind. And he like shakes us out of the emotion of the trials of this life and says, keep the end in mind. He wants us to have this perspective. So verse 1 explains who this is for, who it's from. And then the first words that he writes to the audience here in verse 2, he says this, God the Father knew you and he chose you long ago. And he sent his spirit and his spirit has made you holy. And as a result, you have obeyed him and have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. May God give you more and more grace and peace. I love this. The first thing that he says to an audience, a community that is experiencing hardship, it's difficult and challenging. He says, I want to remind you, God knew you. He knew you. He knew not just your strengths, he knew your weaknesses. He knew what you were bad at. He knew what you would never be able to accomplish on it. He knew you, the good, the bad, and the ugly. You're fully exposed before him. He knew you. And he didn't look for somebody else. He didn't walk away and say, well, maybe if you can improve, then I will choose you. He says he knew you and he chose you. And he didn't just choose you, he made you holy through his Holy Spirit. And he has cleansed you by the blood of Jesus. I want you to remember that God knew you. He chose you. He cleansed you. He made you holy. And because he's done this, we're going to obey him. The result is you obey him. I want to tell you, if you're here today and you are a believer in Jesus, I want to remind you the beauty of Easter. He knew you at your worst. And he chose you. And he gave his very best for you. And you have become justified. You've been declared righteous. You've been made holy, not by the good works that you have done, but by his love and the power of the blood of Jesus. The movement of the Holy Spirit that has drawn you into faith has made you holy. And then as he's made us holy, we live our lives in obedience to him. Of course, it changes the way that we live because we've been transformed by the love and the grace and the mercy of a God who knew us and chose us. This is where he starts. His big encouragement to them is he knew you and he chose you. And he says, and as you walk through this life, I'm just praying this grace that you've received, you get more and more grace and more peace. We're gonna talk about trials in a minute, and I hope you have grace for the trial. I hope you have peace in the trial. And he just pumps up his audience who is suffering with, hey, I know it's tough, but he knew you and he chose you. And straight from that moment, he says in verse 3, all praise to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In a text about trials to a people who are suffering, his first admonition is a call for the reader to a place of worship and to praise. What I see here is Peter saying, like, I know it's challenging. In fact, I'm suffering imprisonment myself. Like, I know it's tough. But when I start thinking about the gospel of a God who knew me and loved me and chose me and made me holy, I just got to take a praise break for a minute. We just got to stop and worship him. I know it's tough, but let's worship together for a moment. I know we got a lot of different backgrounds of your faith or of church history coming together here at Anchor. I know there are some that have some really conservative backgrounds, maybe some that maybe are more reformed backgrounds. I know there's different backgrounds coming together. But have you ever been a part of a church that had some praise breaks? like we see here. Maybe the preacher starts preaching the gospel and people just get a little bit rowdy. Maybe you've seen it on YouTube. I know some of you are like, you're already uncomfortable that you're in a hand-raising church today. You're starting to get used to that still. But there's churches, there's times where the gospel's being preached and people just get a little bit excited. I was a part of a church for a while where right on the aisle every week is where Grandma Pearl sat. And Grandma Pearl, she came every week in her Sunday best. She had a dress, she had high heels, she had a hat, not just an Easter hat. Every Sunday she had a hat and a hanky. And whenever the gospel was preached, I mean, without fail, every Sunday, at one point while the preacher's preaching, Grandma Pearl's getting all worked up about the gospel. She gets up and she gets the hanky and she is dancing down the aisles every Sunday. And people are getting stirred up and cheering and clapping. And preachers got to go take a water break because the crowd is just so into what the gospel means to them. And there's a praise break in church. I'm not telling you, you have to do that. I know that's super uncomfortable for some of us, but I love that. I think Peter was a little bit of a charismatic guy. He's like, I know it's hard. I know there's chains and there's scars on our bodies, but I was called, I was known, I was chosen, and I just gotta praise him for a minute. There's something inside of us that can get so focused on the trial of today and where's God and why this, and this is hard and this hurts and there's suffering. But if we would take a moment to recall once again the beauty of the gospel, what we celebrate on this Easter, that I was known and I was chosen and I was made holy and there is hope available for me. I think even in the chains, in the trial, and our conservative backgrounds, we can take a praise break. You might find yourself even doing this for a second. You keep your hanky to yourself, but man, maybe you will express praise and worship to God when we recall the gospel. He says this, it is by his great mercy that we have been born again because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. He says, all praise to God because we were born again because Jesus was risen from the dead. Now, you've likely heard the term born again. If you've been in church a while, you've certainly heard it likely. Even if you're not a church person, you've heard the phrase born again or born again Christians. It's a concept that we see in Scripture of what is necessary for us to experience forgiveness and hope and salvation is this second birth, this being born again. If that's confusing to you, you're not sure what exactly that means, we're gonna talk about it for a second here, but you're not the only one. In fact, Jesus has a conversation with a religious person, this guy named Nicodemus in John chapter 3, and Jesus talks about being born again, and Nicodemus, he scratches his head. He's like, are you telling me that I need to crawl back into my mother at this stage of my life? Because that's going to be a real awkward Easter lunch if that's what you're asking me to do. And she's like, no, that's not what I'm talking about. There's a spiritual birth that is necessary that I'm calling all people to. To explain born again, let's look at just a couple of verses. John chapter 1, starting at verse 10, it says, he, speaking of Jesus, he came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. He came to his own people and even they rejected him. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. He says a reborn, a born again. And this being born again, it is to anyone who, it says in here, anyone who believes him and accepts him. That to be born again isn't this crazy series of events and tasks you have to accomplish. To be born again is a work that God is doing for anyone who believes and accepts Jesus, his life, death, his resurrection, becomes born again. In that conversation I referenced with Jesus and Nicodemus in John chapter 3, verse 5, Jesus says this to the man. He says, I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of heaven without being born of water and the Spirit. No one can enter the kingdom of heaven without this. It's really important. Verse 6 says, humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. So don't be surprised when I say you must be born again. Because to be born again is how we enter to eternity, to his kingdom, to salvation, to heaven. It says you must be born again. It's a work of the Spirit, that there is a Holy Spirit of God that is working inside of us, that is drawing us unto faith in Jesus. And there's moments, and maybe today is a moment like that for you, where there is a drawing into, where grace is being extended to us and faith begins to stir. And at the moment where there is an acceptance that Jesus did what I could not do for myself, that he is the way to hope, the way to forgiveness, the way to salvation, when that is believed and received, a supernatural experience happens where you are born a second time, a spiritual rebirth. And so Peter is speaking to those, by his mercy, we've been born again because Jesus rose from the dead. We have the ability for a second birth. So as we jump into the main course for our last minutes here together today, we have two groups of people in this room, watching online, two groups of people. Those who have had just one birth, you've been physically born, you are into existence here on this planet, and those who have been born again, you've had a second birth. And this text is written to the audience of those who were born again. Peter's using terminology of those who are already following Christ, those who have already been born again. He's speaking to that audience. But so we're going to talk about this inheritance. We're going to talk about this hope for those that are born again. But I also want to say that those in the room today that haven't experienced the second birth, haven't put your faith in Jesus, accepted him as the Lord of your life, everything that we're talking about that is our great hope, our great expectation, it is available to anyone who will believe, who will receive. That everything here is on the table for you. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that anyone who believes in him shall not perish, but have this eternal life that is the hope of our souls. It could be available for you today. So he transitions from here in verse 3. He says, because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, now we live with great expectation. If you are born again, this should define our lives. No matter what is happening around us, we are a people that live with great expectation. This is my hope and my prayer for the big takeaway today. And if you've got your own Bible, you should underline the words great expectation, that this is how we live our lives. Because Jesus rose from the dead, we live with great expectation. Expectation, by definition, it is a belief in something that is yet to take place, but you are fully confident that it will. We live with great expectation. We fully believe, we are confident that something we've yet to experience will happen. And when we have that kind of confidence, it dictates our perspective, our behavior, the way that we live, because we are not wondering if it will happen. We have great expectation that what we have not yet seen or experienced, it is ours. We will experience it someday. And because we actually believe it, it dictates the way that we live today. We are those that live with great expectation. What is it that we are expecting? We go on in verse 4. He says, we have a priceless inheritance. An inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure, undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. We have an inheritance, priceless inheritance. An inheritance is something that is yours. Your name is on it, but you don't possess it yet. But it is yours. You just don't have it. You will have it. It's yours, but you're not living in it yet. This is an inheritance, and it is priceless. And this priceless inheritance, it is in heaven, and it is heaven, and all that heaven means, all that it entails, all that it encapsulates, is it's ours. If you've been born again, this is the inheritance we have. But it is not for us to experience, to hold on to in the brokenness of this world. It's ours, but it's being kept for us. Being kept safe where it cannot be changed, cannot be broken, it cannot wear out or decay by the sin and the brokenness of this world. It's being kept for us, not given to us today where we have the opportunity to self-sabotage the inheritance. If we receive it too early, we could wreck it. He's like, it's yours, but I'm keeping it safe, undefiled, perfect for you, and it will be yours someday. Pure and undefiled is speaking to the condition of our existence that will be free from sin, free from the consequences of sin, free from the implications of sin, not just in our lives, but in the people around us. It's speaking to an eternity that we would have an incredibly hard time trying to comprehend. We don't know what it's like to live a day without worry about what sin and its consequences are, sickness and death, a life without fear of what someone else may or may not do. There are no locks, there's no security codes, there's like no need for anything because there is no sin, there is no danger, there is no fear of what someone else could do. Free from sin in my own life and the consequences that come with it. An existence free from greed, from pride, from lust, from cheating. And an existence that is free from tears, death, tragedy, loss. An existence free from sickness. And when we walk into this inheritance, it will not fade, decay, become stale or stagnant or boring. It will be glory upon glory upon glory for all eternity. And if we've been there for a long time and it's starting to feel stale or we're used to this, there's gonna be new levels of glory that's gonna blow our minds again. And it will be perpetual glory upon glory. Will not grow old, will not grow stagnant, will not grow stale. And in this eternity, we will inherit our eternal bodies that will not become sick, will not age, break down, droop, or sag. It's gonna be a great day. And for eternity. But the best part is not just health and eternal existence and great delight, but we will be existing in the complete love and holiness of God Almighty and behold our Jesus face to face, captivated. This is a state that we long for now, but we don't experience until later. It's our inheritance. It's no less ours, but it stirs inside of us a desire and a hunger for what is to come. We live with great expectation that what we don't see when we look around this world and the circumstances of our own life and the trials and the diagnoses and the loss and the pain and the grieving, we don't see it yet. But we have a hope, a great expectation. I think maybe another way to phrase it is that our souls are homesick on this earth. We're longing for something more. We're longing for health. We're longing for healing in our relationships. We're longing for healing in our own bodies and the bodies of our loved ones. And we want to be free from the pain and the sting of brokenheartedness and abandonment and abuse. And we look around this world and it's just scratching our heads of like, there's got to be something else that we're trying to find fulfillment in this life. I wanna tell you, our souls are homesick until we walk into the inheritance. The remedy for the homesicknesses of our soul is only found in the hope of the resurrection of Jesus. Maybe you're here today and you felt or are feeling that homesickness, believing that there's got to be more. Why is life so hard? Why is culture so messed up? Maybe you're asking questions like, what am I even here for? What's the purpose of all of this? I would tell you, Peter would urge you to consider the death and the resurrection of Jesus as the remedy for the homesickness of your soul. Now in these last two verses we look at today, Peter addresses the challenges of life head on. He says in verse 5, and through your faith, God is protecting you by his power until you receive this salvation, until you walk into that inheritance. He's protecting you until that day, which is ready to be revealed on the last day for all to see. I'm gonna tell you that God is protecting, he is providing, he is sustaining you until it is time to enter into that inheritance. And it is that inheritance that is his ultimate desire for you. It's not the most comfortable life on this planet that's his ultimate desire for you. It's that you would walk on that day when this temporary life is over and you walk into that inheritance, that is his ultimate desire for you. I know there's lots of questions when it comes to tragedy, when it comes to sickness, when it comes to death, when it comes to pain. I know that there's some of you that are walking through seasons of deep pain right now. I'm sorry for tragedy. I'm sorry for sin and the consequences of sin and the painful circumstances you're walking through, and I have no desire to belittle the painful experience that you are walking through. but it is a reminder that we must find a hope outside of this broken world. That when we are suffering, when we're in trial, when we're grieving, it is a reminder that our souls are homesick, that we were never gonna be able to find that satisfaction, that delight that that lasts on this planet, that there has to be something outside that we find our hope in. And in verse 6, he says, so be truly glad. There's wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. It's like you might look around and you might see trial, you might see pain, you might see grief, but when we keep an eye on what is ahead, joy remains. We cannot look to the comforts of this life for any lasting joy. This life will leave us wanting. Our souls were never designed to find satisfaction here. And I know that this thought is a little bit heavy. But I think it's important for us to come face to face with our own mortality. And we do at times, but we like to push it away and not think about it. But the truth is, our lives are gonna come to an end. No matter if we recover from this illness, we get that thing that we're desiring, like it's gonna come to an end. And as painful as it is to think about, every person that we love, this temporary life will come to an end. And if we are looking for hope, we're looking for fulfillment, we're looking for purpose here in this life, our best option is just delayed disappointment. Can we just push off the broken down body a little bit longer? Can we just get through this sickness? Can we just get through this? Can we have that experience? But at the end of the day, it's going to be challenging. Our lives will come to an end. We're gonna have to walk through the painful grieving seasons of people we love and their lives coming to an end. But if we're looking for hope and purpose and fulfillment in the confident hope of eternity, our worst option is delayed perfection with an opportunity to bring some other people into hope while we're here. That's what Peter's doing. He's like, I got hope. I know where I'm going. Someday my life's gonna be taken because of the message I'm sharing, but I'm just gonna tell as many people as I can the hope that I have found that helps me endure whatever trial I'm facing. He's sharing hope with everyone. And church, there are gonna be trials here in the temporary, but the life and the comforts of this world were never our goal. I wanna speak to those here today who are holding on to your faith while sickness is overtaking your body. You are worshiping your Savior in such a precious way. Those of you here today that are holding on to your faith while you're grieving the loss of someone you love dearly, which I know some of you are in this season, you are worshiping your King in such a precious way. I'm gonna ask the band to join me, and I wanna look at one last verse written by the Apostle Paul, a contemporary of Peter. He writes this to believers in Corinth. It's found in the book of 2 Corinthians. Chapter 4, verse 14 says this, we know that God, who raised the Lord Jesus, will also raise us with Jesus and present us to himself together with you. And all of this is for your benefit. And as God's grace reaches more and more people, there will be great thanksgiving and God will receive more and more glory. That is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long, yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. Because Jesus was risen, we believe that we will raise to new life. And when we keep the end in mind and don't get so captivated by today's emotions and today's trials, we will be of those that do not give up. We don't quit, we endure. Because we fix our eyes not on the circumstances that are right in front of us today. We've got our eyes fixed on what is unseen. Our circumstances can take our glance, but Jesus gets our gaze. And we fix our eyes on Jesus. Hebrews 12 says that we're running this race of faith and we run it with endurance by fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. goes on to say, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and is seated at the right hand of God. It says, consider him, consider Jesus, who endured such opposition from sinful men so that you won't grow weary, so that you won't lose heart. That in our trial, our endurance is not found in our own ability, our own discipline, our own effort. It is found in keeping our eyes on Jesus, who didn't just tell us to do this, but he, for the joy set before him, endured the cross. The joy that was before him is that he was gonna pay the penalty for our sin, to pay the redemption price for you to be forgiven, for you to walk into an inheritance that will not fade or grow old. He says, that joy will fuel me through the cross. And we consider him when we're facing trial, grief, pain, and when we have an eye on eternity, when we live with great expectation. It doesn't mean that the trials aren't real or that this life is broken and it hurts, but we consider him and we don't give up. We will be of those that finish well, those that finish strong. I want to tell you the gospel story is about glory on the other side of adversity. It's the story of Easter. It's the glory of resurrection on the other side of the trial of the cross. I'll tell you our story, our redemption, our hope. It's that just like Easter, it's the glory of eternity in the presence of God on the other side of the trials of this life. Our only option in this life is that it will come to an end. Yet we can be of those with hope. We can be of those that live with great expectation. Heaven is coming. If you're willing and able, would you stand with me? Again, I want to address the two audiences in the room today. Those of you that are here today, and you are a believer in Jesus, by definition, born again. You have accepted his free gift. You put your faith in him as the Savior of your soul. My challenge to you on this Easter Sunday is that we live like those with great expectation. I think for some of us, we need to be shaken out of the emotion of the moment right now. We can look around at our nation, our world, our culture, and just be so worked up and caught up and frustrated and angry. I think maybe this morning is time to get an eye back on what is unseen. And all that trial of this world is just an indication, yes, your soul is homesick. Look again to the gospel. In our days on this earth, rather than just being grumpy and frustrated and angry at everything happening, what if we just use this opportunity to share the hope that we found to a world that desperately needs it? To those of you today that's you come into this moment and you're not a believer in Jesus, by definition, not born again, I want to tell you today, could be your day. I think the fact that you're here is evidence enough for me that the Holy Spirit is working on your life. He's drawing you unto the love of the Father. You don't have to wonder, is he working on me? You're here, you're at church. The gospel's being presented to you. He's after you. He knows you. What you've done, what you've said, what you've thought, what you believed, nothing's hidden from him. And he's chosen you. And he's died for you. He's paid the full price to forgive everything that you've done. And he offers you the opportunity. Will you receive? Not just forgiveness for what you've done, but a hope for eternity so you can live this life with great expectation. We really don't believe that you have to say certain words or you have to check all these certain boxes or fulfill all these requirements. We believe that the Holy Spirit stirs inside of your heart and faith begins to arise. And there's just a moment where you're just... it's faith. You're believing and receiving the gift of Jesus. We think that articulating that or saying that to someone, like making a firm statement that that is what you've decided, I think that's super helpful. But you don't have to say certain words or do a certain process. It's faith stirring in your heart today. But what we do offer as a church is to not leave you alone trying to figure out what it means to receive and follow Jesus. So what we have available to you is on the chair in front of you, there's a QR code. If you take out your phone and you open the camera, if you just point that camera there, a link will pop up. If you just click that, the first option says there, it says ready to follow Jesus. And you don't have to hit ready to follow Jesus to be granted forgiveness and eternal life, but it's a way for the church to come alongside of you and to pray for you and answer any questions and not just leave you to figure this out on your own. So we just would ask you, if today's a day where you're ready to follow Jesus, would you take that simple step, scan that QR code, and someone will, whatever's convenient to you, give you a phone call or just shoot you a text or email you. We want to resource you. We want a relationship with you. We don't want you to try to figure this out on your own. Here's the last thing I want to say, back to those who are born again. Some of you brought family with you today, and I know I'm putting you in a real awkward spot here. Well, maybe not. But I would encourage you, as the band's going to lead us in one last song, what if you just asked your loved ones, hey, where are you at? Have you been born again? Have you put your faith in Jesus? And I know that that might be a little moment of discomfort, but if we believe what we believe, I think it's pretty selfish to avoid a moment of discomfort when an eternal, priceless inheritance could be received by the people that we love the most. I just would encourage you. I don't know your relational dynamic with the people around you, but what would it be like to say, hey, I love you enough to just ask, can I be praying for you? Where's the day that you'd like to put your faith in Jesus? Maybe you don't even know what to do from there. Well, scan the QR code. We'll help you out. But we've got homesick souls. Let's offer hope. Jesus, we love you. We're going to take these last few moments corporately to worship you once again on this Easter. And Holy Spirit, I just believe you've been at work, not just in the last hour together, but you're always at work. You're drawing people unto hope. Sometimes it's the very trials and tragedies of life that make us aware of how homesick we are. So Lord, would you just use what's going on in our lives to draw us to hope in you? Father, thank you that anyone who believes will not perish eternally, but have eternal life with you. Thank you that that is the hope that is available to anyone and everyone who will receive. I want to pray for those that today there's turmoil in their hearts right now, that this would be a moment of salvation, a moment of forgiveness, a moment of hope. God, we love you. We worship you on this Easter. In your name we pray. Amen. We'll dismiss in just a moment, but let's pray and worship together with one last song.
And how great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could
sealed the promise, your buried body began to break.
would like to get more connected, we'd love to get to know your story. There's that QR code right in front of you on that chair. Go ahead and scan that with your camera. There's a button you can press called Ready to Connect. We'd love to get you paired up with somebody for a cup of coffee, get to know your story a little bit more, answer any questions you might have. We'd also love to see you back here next Sunday. We're back here at our normal time at 10 a.m. And I want you to know I've been specifically told, grab donuts on your way out. I was going to tell you have a happy Easter, but I'll just tell you to go grab a donut because good luck grabbing a donut and not having a happy Easter. So again, grab one on your way out. I'm grateful for you guys being here with us, and I hope to see you back next week.